Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our Smarter CA webinar series on Taxation of Capital Gains, a Deep Dive. Today's speaker is Dr. Ravi Gupta. He is an advocate and leading tax consultant at Delhi NCR. He is a co-author of various books on income tax. He is also a council member of ICAI, Government of India nominee, and on the board of various reputed companies. He did his graduation and post-graduation from SRCC Delhi University. Thereafter, he did his LLB from DU and MBA from FMS Delhi. During the webinar, if you would like to ask Dr. Gupta anything, please share your questions by clicking on the Q&A button towards the bottom of the webinar window. We will address these towards the end of the webinar. And now it's over to Dr. Gupta.
Thank you, Neha. At the outset, it's a pleasure to be sharing this on this webinar. And I'm very happy that we are utilizing this lockdown period for enhancing our knowledge. And I find that a lot of people, a lot of professionals are joining the webinars and keeping themselves abreast of the latest developments. And it is a good learning opportunity for all of us. And I welcome all the participants also. The topic assigned to us today is taxation of capital gains. Well, friends, capital gains taxation is in itself a very wide topic, and we could go on discussing for days together. But what I plan to do today is that I will first take you through the basic provisions. While we are going through the provisions, we will also discuss some issues which are normally faced by the taxpayers. Some issues we will address during the proceedings itself of the webinar. Other questions that come to your mind, other issues that come up, you can keep jotting them. We will take up those issues at the end of the session. My friends, starting with capital gains, section 45(1) starts with the basis of the charge. 45(1) says that capital gain arises when there is a transfer of a capital asset, and it is chargeable to tax in the year in which the transfer takes place. So three things emerge from this. First of all, there has to be a capital asset. Secondly, there has to be a transfer of that capital asset. And thirdly, in normal circumstances, that capital gain which arises on the transfer will be taxable in the year in which the transfer takes place. However, we will come across certain exceptions where the capital gain may be taxable not in the year of transfer, but in some other year. So what we need to know is, first of all, what is a capital asset? And secondly, what is a transfer? These two are very important concepts and have been well defined in the Act. And by way of judicial pronouncements, now we are quite sure about what is the interpretation of these two terms. Firstly, what is a capital asset? Section 2, bracket 14, discusses what is a capital asset. The definition is an inclusive definition. It says capital asset includes property of any description, movable, immovable, tangible, intangible, whether connected with the business or not connected with the business. So therefore, we start with a very wide perspective. We say capital asset includes property of any description. Right? So it could be either a movable property, for example, a car, jewelry, all these are movable. It could be immovable, a house, land, these are immovable properties. It could be tangible, intangible, like a house is tangible. Goodwill is an intangible asset, but we all know that goodwill is also a capital asset. Right? It could be connected with my business. I could have a factory building, or it may not be connected. It could be a residential house. So therefore, all these sort of assets can be called a capital asset. Now, the definition proceeds to say, but does not include the following. So what we have done is we have excluded a few things from the definition of a capital asset. Firstly, we have excluded any asset of the nature of a stock in trade, raw material, or consumable stores which are held by the SSE for the purpose of his business. So this is a very important exclusion. So therefore, anything which I hold as my stock in trade, anything which I hold as raw material for my business, these will not be a capital asset. Right? As you are all aware, when I sell these assets, these will give rise to a business income rather than a capital. So stock in trade, etc. are not capital assets. Secondly, I have excluded personal effects. Personal effects meaning thereby all movable assets which are held by the SSE for his own or the use of his family, which are intimate personal assets. Right? Here, remember, personal assets will include only movable assets. Immovable property, although personal, my own residential house, will not be excluded in the nature of a personal asset. Then we say that personal assets will not include jewelry, paintings, sculptures, work of any art, etc. So what could be called a personal asset? For example, the furniture that I have at my house, the clothes that I wear, a watch that I wear, a pen that I have for my personal use, all these are personal assets. So therefore, they have been excluded from the definition of capital asset. Any profit that may arise on the transfer of these assets will not be subject to capital. Right? We have excluded specifically jewelry. When I define jewelry, jewelry does not only mean ornaments. It includes ornaments, of course, but it also includes gold, silver, platinum, precious stones in whatever form they are held. So for example, let us say I have some furniture at my home in which there are diamonds studded at that on that furniture. Then it will no longer be a personal. If I am wearing a wristwatch which has a gold chain and there are diamonds in that watch, then it no longer is a personal effect. Then it becomes jewelry, which has been excluded from personal. Right? There was a lot of issues on what would be the treatment of, let us say, silver utensils. Now, many people, especially royal families, used to have silver utensils which were used in their day-to-day utility. Now, if these are silver utensils which are used on a daily basis, then these can be called personal. But if I keep them only as an investment, then they are not personal effects. Then they will be held to be capital assets. Similarly, all sorts of jewelry, all sorts of other bullion, etc., will be a capital asset. So I have excluded stock in trade, raw material. I have excluded personal effects. Thirdly, I will exclude agricultural land, which is not an urban agricultural land. Right? Agricultural income we know is exempt. Similarly, any gain that arises on transfer of rural agricultural land is also not to be taxed because it is not considered to be a capital asset. Now, what is agricultural land has been defined according to the distance, according to the municipality. It can be 2 kilometers away from the municipality, 6 kilometers or 8 kilometers away from a municipality. We can have that detailed definition of what is agricultural land. Now, this distance, it has been clarified, has to be measured aerially. So from the municipal limits, I have to see how far is the agricultural land. If it falls outside the prescribed limits, it can be qualified to be rural agricultural land and will therefore be excluded from the definition of a capital asset. So this is what is defined as what is a capital asset, right? So it can be property of any description. Then we have added an explanation to section 214, where we have clarified that a right to or in relation to any Indian company is also an asset. Right? So therefore, property will include any rights in or in relation to any company, including rights of management or control or any other rights whatsoever. This explanation was inserted primarily after the Vodafone decision, where we wanted to tax any shares of Indian companies which give a controlling right, even if the shares have been transferred outside India. So we have included that in the definition of the term capital asset also. Now, if you go through the definition carefully, two important points that need to be analyzed here. Firstly, the definition says capital asset means property of any description held by the assessor. Now, what do I mean by the term held by the assessor? Now, see here, held term is used in contradiction to owned by the assessor. Now, the question is, can I be holding an asset without being the owner of that asset? Right? You come across so many cases where a person holds an asset which has a value which can be transferred, but he may not be owning it. Right? For example, let us say the tenancy rights. I'm a tenant in a property. Do I own that property? No. What is my asset? My asset is the tenancy right that I have. We will see in detail a little later that this tenancy right can also be transferred, and this is also a capital asset. Right? A right in an asset is also a capital asset. So therefore, what is required is that the assessee must be holding that asset, not necessarily that he must be the owner of that asset. This concept will become clearer when you see so many provisions, for example, section 54B. When we'll discuss about 54B, we can see there that a person may not be owning the agricultural land. Even if he's a tenant of that land, he is cultivating that land, then also the exemption is available to him. So this is the first point that I wanted to make, that we are using the word here held by the assessor. Secondly, the nature of the asset we have to analyze on the date of transfer of the asset. On that date, what was the asset? What was the nature of the asset? Was it a capital asset or not? If it is a capital asset on the date of the transfer, then only the question arises of the capital. Right? For example, I have some agricultural land. Right? Maybe it is rural agricultural land. I have been holding that land for the last 20 years for agriculture purposes. Then I get that land converted. I get a CLU of that land, and now I want to construct a project on that. Once the land has been converted, it is no longer agricultural land. So now when I sell this land which has been converted, it answers the description of a capital asset. Although earlier it was excluded, being agricultural land. So now what I have to see is, on the date of transfer, what is the nature of that asset? Is it a capital asset or not? On the date of transfer, if it is a capital asset, yes, there will be a capital. If it is not a capital asset on that date, it will not be a capital. Then friends, as you know, capital assets can be divided into two categories, short-term capital asset, long-term capital asset. We need not go into discussion on that. Short-term capital asset generally means an asset which is held for not more than 36 months. In some cases, the period is 24 months. For example, in case of unlisted shares, in case of land and building now, it is 24 months. In case of shares, listed shares, etc., it is only a period of 12 months. So generally, it is 36 months. Some cases 24 months, some cases 12 months. So this period helps me determining whether an asset is a long-term capital asset or is it a short-term capital asset. Then there are some issues involved in this also. There could be a case where it is, say, I have held a land for the last 20 years. But I constructed certain flats on that land during the last year. And I sell the flats. Now the question that arises is it a short-term capital gain or is it a long-term capital gain? And the land I have held for 20 years, the building that I am selling, I held only for 12 months. Right? Now we have a number of cases on this where it has been held that even if the land is held earlier, the building is completed today, then we can split the capital gain into two portions. Right? We have the popular case of CIT versus Vimalchand Goelcha, which is 201 ITR, Rajasthan High Court, where the court said that the gain attributable to the land will be taxed as long-term capital gain and the gains attributable to the building will be treated as a short-term capital. So we can bifurcate this capital gain into two parts, right? Although the asset sold is the building along with the land, but yes, I can bifurcate that capital gain into two parts. Similarly, we have some cases where, let us say my leasehold property, I owned certain leasehold property, got that converted into a freehold property and then sold that property. So conversion may have taken place only last year. The original property I held for a number of years. So is this long term? Is this short term? Right? Again, we have a couple of decisions which have said that the period of holding will include the earlier period also. Because when I held the leasehold property, that was also my asset. It is the same property which I have got converted into freehold property. There are a lot of disputed cases on when I acquire a right in a property. In many cases, what happens is that I purchase a property, I book a property with a builder, I pay him a substantial amount of money. The builder had promised to give it to me in 2 years, 3 years, but it takes 8 years to complete the construction. Now, when I get the property after 8 years, I sell it in the 9th year. The question is it long term? Is it short term? Right? Now we have fortunately plenty of cases where it has been held that the period of holding will start from the date when I booked the property. Right? Because that is the point of time that I acquired a major interest in that property. If you want, I'll give you the case laws on this also a little later. But there are now plenty of cases on this that the period of holding in this case will start from the date that I booked the flat and I paid a substantial amount of money to the builder to acquire that right. This also brings us to the question of when I transfer my asset, will it be a capital gain or will it be a business gain? If what I am transferring is a capital asset, there will be a business income. If I am transferring a capital asset, there will be a capital gain. If I am transferring any asset other than a capital asset, it could be a business. At times, it becomes hard to make a distinction. And we might be faced with a controversy. And there are case laws on both the sides. Major problem arises in case of shares. When I acquire shares of a company and sell them, whether it is a capital gain or not depends upon so many factors. Depends upon what was the period of holding of the shares, how many shares have I purchased, what was the frequency of the transactions, what was the mode of financing of the transactions. All these have to be taken into consideration. In certain cases, there was an SSE who had about 8,000 transactions of shares in a year. He used to borrow money also for investing in the shares and would then sell the shares. It was clearly held that now this is a business of the SSE to buy and sell shares. So this, therefore, this shall be taxed as a business income. Then we have certain circulars issued by the board two important circulars, circular number 4 dated 15th of June 2007 and then a CBDT order dated 2nd of May 2016 which have tried to lay down certain principles for deciding as to whether a particular transaction of shares will be a capital gain or will it be a business. Again, as I told you, the parameters are the same. The frequency of the transactions, the period of holding of the shares, the method in which I reflect them in my books of account, the means of financing the transactions, all these will have an important impact on deciding whether it is a business income or is it a capital. Similarly, when I sell, let us say, a piece of land, I purchased the land, let us say I owned a huge chunk of land, maybe about 20 acres of land I own, which is very old land, maybe ancestral land. Then I decide to sell the land by cutting them into small pieces and selling each piece as a separate, let us say, a residential plot. Now, when I sell each plot, and now I have with me, let us say, 500 or 700 plots which I'm selling, is this a business or is it just my capital gain by transfer of the capitalist? Here again, we have case laws on both the sides, depending on the facts of the case. The main criteria which the courts have adopted in this case is, what was the intention when I purchased the asset? Did I purchase it for making a profit? Did I purchase it for holding as a capital asset? In one case, the assessee got a land from his ancestors. He held that land for a substantial period, for maybe 5, 10, 20 years. Then, in order to get a better price, he sold them in small chunks. The court said, yes, this is a capital asset. This will be a capital. But if I purchase a huge plot of land and immediately get it converted, divide it into plots and then sell it, then it will be characterized as a business or an adventure in the nature of trade, which will have to be taxed as my income from business. Then coming to the second important aspect of capital gain, that brings us to the question of what is a transfer. The term transfer has been defined in section 247. Again, a very inclusive definition, a very wide definition, a very complicated definition. 247 again starts with the clause, transfer includes. So this is again an inclusive definition. It says transfer includes, first clause, includes the sale, exchange, or the relinquishment of a capital asset. Right? So there are three terms used in the first clause, which says transfer includes sale, exchange, relinquishment of the asset. Now, sale is a very common phenomena. Whenever I sell an asset for a price, for a consideration in terms of money, then I say it is a sale. And these are the most frequent transactions that we come across. I sell any capital asset and I get a price for that in terms of money. It is a sale. Exchange is another system where we barter things. I give my land to a person and in exchange I get gold from him. That is called an exchange. Now let us say I have a piece of land which costed me, which my cost was 2 lakh rupees. Today the market value is 50 lakh rupees. I exchange that with someone with gold worth 50 lakh rupees. He had purchased that gold for 5 lakh rupees. Now both priced at 50 lakhs, market value of both the assets is 50 lakhs. I give my land of 50 lakhs, take gold of 50 lakhs. Is there a capital gain to anyone? Well, in fact, in this case, there will be a capital gain to both the persons. Because both the persons have exchanged their asset, changed the form of the asset, and therefore we'll have to compute the capital gains in both the cases. Third element of this first process, it shall also include the relinquishment of the asset. Now, when I give up my asset, maybe for a consideration, maybe not for a consideration. If I relinquish the asset without consideration, then it will amount to a gift, which we will cover under Section 47, which may not be treated as a transfer. But if the relinquishment of the asset is for a consideration, it will be treated as a transfer. And there will be a capital gain on that. Second clause of the definition says, transfer includes the extinguishment of any rights therein. Therein means in the asset. Now here observe that we are using the word extinguishment of any rights in the asset. We are not saying extinguishment of the asset. What do I mean by extinguishment? Extinguishment means that the asset will no longer exist. If the asset no longer exists, then the question is, can this be a transfer? Right? We have the popular case of decided by the Supreme Court of one asset means. Where the person had got an asset insured, and when the asset was destroyed, he got a substantial amount from the insurance company. The income tax department wanted to tax it. But the SEC said, where is the transfer? The asset ceases to exist. So when an asset ceases to exist, how can then the asset be transferred? So therefore, the court said that there cannot be a capital gain because the asset has extinguished. Right? To overcome that, we have inserted a new section, 45(1)(a), which we'll be discussing a little later. Coming back to the clause that we use here, he says the extinguishment of any rights therein. Now, to give an example, see, I enter into an agreement to sell a piece of land for rupees 5 crores. Now, when I enter into the agreement for 5 crore rupees, I give the seller 60 days time, or the seller gives me 60 days time to make the payment. I pay him a token money of rupees 5 lakhs. By paying this 5 lakh rupees, what do I get? Do I become the owner of that land? No. I merely get a right to purchase that asset for the consideration which was determined in the agreement. Now, tomorrow, for any reason, the seller gets another buyer who's willing to pay him double the price. Can he sell it to him? He cannot, because he has made an enforceable contract with me. So therefore, he approaches me, tells me that I will give you 20 lakh rupees if you give up your right. I had given you only 5 lakh rupees. He gives me 20 lakh rupees to extinguish my right in that asset. Now that right was also a capital asset. So I am extinguishing that right for a consideration. So this will also give a rise to a capital gain. We have a popular case on this, Vijay Flexible, where it has been held that extinguishing the right in an asset also will be a capital gain. And we have the specific provision also contained in section 247. Third clause deals with the compulsory acquisition thereof under any law. So if my asset is compulsory acquired by the government, only the government has a right to acquire an asset. If the government makes a compulsory acquisition of any land, building, etc., then whatever compensation the government pays to me, that also will give rise to a capital gain. Right. So whatever compensation I get is my sale consideration minus my cost, index cost, etc. will give rise to a capital gain. Fourth clause talks about conversion of a capital asset into stock in trade. We will deal with this a little later when I am dealing with section 45(2), where the treatment of the conversion of the capital asset into stock in trade, and now vice versa, conversion of a stock and trade into capital asset. Both we will deal with that in a separate transaction. Then maturity or redemption of zero coupon bonds is also deemed to be a transfer. I will deal with this also separately. 247(5). This is the most important clause and the most controversial one, which has been affected a lot of business transactions, especially of real estate transactions. First, let us say what this clause says. This says any transaction involving the allowing of the possession of any immovable property to be taken or retained in part performance of a contract, which is of the nature referred to in section 53A of the Transfer of Property Act. Now, this section, first of all, deals with only immovable properties and deals with cases where the possession of a property has been handed over without actual transfer as per the requirements of the Transfer of Property Act. Now, if I come to section 53A, what are the requirements of section 53A of the Transfer of Property Act? It says, first of all, it must be a transaction for immovable property. It must be a contract in writing. It must be signed by the parties. The possession of the property has been taken over by the transferee, and the transferee is ready and willing to perform his part of the promise of the agreement. If these conditions are satisfied, then 247(5) can be invoked, and this transaction will amount to a transfer of the property, even though, strictly speaking, under the Transfer of Property Act, the registration of the property may not yet have been taken place. I will come to this clause little later when I am going to deal in detail about certain development agreements. We will be using this clause again. And what are the recent cases on this? We have, in fact, two recent very important Supreme Court judgments where it has been held that in the absence of registration of such an agreement, of whether it is joint development agreement or transfer agreement, it does not fall under Section 53 of the Transfer of Property Act, and consequently, Section 247(5) will not apply. So therefore, in order to invoke 247(5), it has been held that it is necessary that the agreement by which the possession has been given must have been registered. This is a very recent 2019 judgment, PCIT versus Chunnilal Bhagat, 2019-262-209 Supreme Court. So we will have to keep this in mind when we are discussing this element again under the taxation of development agreements. Then lastly, this clause also says the transfer includes any transaction by way of becoming a member of a cooperative society or a company, etc., which has the effect of transferring or enabling the enjoyment of any immovable property. Now, when I become a member of a cooperative society, and by virtue of that membership, I acquire a flat or a plot of land in that society, then although that property may be registered in the name of the society, but because I'm a member, I acquire a right to that property. Therefore, if I transfer my membership, it will amount to a transfer of the immovable property. Therefore, this transaction is also covered here. So these were the main clauses that I wanted to refer in the definition of the term transfer. We will be referring these to these various clauses time and again when we are discussing the various applications of these provisions. Friends, now coming to the year of taxability. As I told you, capital gains are normally taxable in the year in which the capital gain, in which the capital asset is transferred. However, we have certain exceptions. Firstly, under section 45(2), where a capital asset is transferred, where a stock in trade is converted to a capital asset, it is taxable in the year of actual sale of the asset, not in the year of conversion, but in the year of actual sale. Similarly, 45(1A), we will deal with that a little separately. It is taxable in the year in which I receive the claim from the insurance company. In case of compulsory acquisition, the capital gain is taxable not in the year of transfer, but in the year that I get the compensation or get a part of the compensation. Capital gain is taxable only in that. So these are some exceptions which we'll be covering as we go along with the provisions. Then a few points on the computation of capital gain. Section 48 primarily deals with how to compute the capital gains. Now, it has been prescribed how to compute long-term capital gain, how to compute short-term capital gain. Primarily, we start with the sale consideration and deduct from that the cost of acquisition or the index cost, the cost of improvement or the index cost of improvement, and thirdly, the expenses on transfer. So if we deduct these three items from my sale consideration, I get my capital gain. As regards the cost of acquisition, some important issues that I want to mention. Especially in cases of long-term capital asset. If the asset had been acquired on any date prior to 1st of April 2001, as you all know, we take the fair market value of the asset as of 2001 to be the cost of that asset. So fair market value on 1st of April 2001 is taken. After that, we start with the indexation. No cost of improvement prior to that is allowed. And there will be obviously no indexation prior to 2001 because 2001 is taken as the base year where I take the index as 100. We have a recent amendment in this budget on this point. Now, when I say that the fair market value on 2001 is to be taken, we have now clarified that if for an asset, the stamp duty value of that asset as on 1st of April 2001 is available, then I will have to take that value. My fair market value cannot be more than that value. Right, so this has been clarified because a lot of SICs were increasing the fair market value for taking advantage of more deduction by way of a greater cost of acquisition being indexed. So now we have clarified that wherever the stamp duty values in 1/4/2001 is taken is available, we will take the cost of acquisition to be the stamp duty value as on 1st of April 2001. Wherever an asset is acquired by an SSC from a previous owner, here we are majorly referring to the transactions covered under section 46, 47, which are not regarded as a transfer. For example, assets acquired through a will, through succession, assets acquired on partition of an HUF, assets acquired by a company on amalgamation, assets acquired on demerger of a company, all these transactions are not regarded as a transfer. Now, I have acquired an asset through these moves, then the cost of acquisition to the transferor is taken to be the cost to the previous owner. And if the previous owner had also not acquired it, he got it through another owner, then we trace it back to the original owner who acquired that asset. And the cost of that owner will be taken to be the cost of acquisition. And if that asset was acquired by the previous owner before 1st of April 2001, we will take the market values at 2001. In respect of bonus shares, the provision is clear. The cost of any financial asset, including bonus shares, which are acquired without any cost, the cost of acquisition shall be taken to be nil. So therefore, I cannot attribute any cost to the bonus shares. Whatever is the sale price shall be deemed to be the capital gain. It could be long term, it could be short term. However, if I had purchased the bonus shares, or if I had acquired the bonus shares, the bonus shares were allotted to me prior to 1st of April 2001. Can I exercise the option to take the market value as at 1/4 2001 to be my cost? There is no prohibition. If I had acquired the bonus shares prior to 1st of April 2001, I can take the market value on 1st April 2001 to be my cost. Then coming to the self-generated assets. Now, that reminds me of the important case of B.C. Srinivasa Shetty, where the courts held that if there is no cost of an asset, then the provisions of Section 48, that is the computation machinery, fails, and therefore there cannot be a tax on any capital gain. Now, the reason given there was that Section 48 defines clearly how to compute capital gains. And when the section says that from my selling price, I have to reduce my cost, if the cost is not known and cannot be determined, then the Supreme Court said that you cannot tax any amount. This was the decision in CIT versus B.C. Srinivasa Shetty. This is 128 ITR 294. Subsequent to this decision, amendment was made, and now we have provided in Section 55 dealing with cost of acquisition, where we say that the cost of acquisition of certain assets which have been specified shall be taken to be nil. So in this section we have defined that cost of acquisition of goodwill of a business, trademark, brand name associated with business, right to manufacture, produce or process any article, right to carry on any business or a profession, tenancy rights, stage carriage permits or loom hours shall be taken to be nil if these are self-generated. If I have purchased any of these assets, then the purchase price will be my cost. If I have generated these assets on my own, then these are called self-generated assets. The cost will be taken to be nil. Therefore, the entire selling price will become the capital. Take the case of an SSE who is staying in a property, in a rented property, right? The common case being, let us say, the tenant rented properties in Connaught Place in Delhi, in Chandni Chowk in Delhi, where we have cases where a person is occupying a shop for the last 70 years, last 80 years, paying a small amount of rent, maybe 50 rupees, 70 rupees a month. Now, does he become the owner of that property? No. What is his asset? His asset is the tenancy right. He can continue to be a tenant there by paying that small amount of rent. Now, the owner approaches him, tells him, I will pay you 5 crore rupees today if you vacate the premises. So what is this SE doing? He is giving up his tenancy rights. What was the cost? Did he pay anything for the tenancy rights? No. He has just been paying rent to enjoy that property over a number of years. He did not get pay anything to acquire the tenancy rights. So his cost is zero. Whatever he gets now will be taxed as a capital gain. Earlier, when we did not have this section, there was no tax liability on account of surrender of the tenancy rights. So here we'll have to be clear that only the assets which have been specified, in those cases, that is assets specified in 55(2)(a), the cost will be taken to be nil. If there are any other self-generated assets, still the Supreme Court judgment will apply, and then that case, because the cost is nil, there cannot be a capital gain. We have some cases where there is a transfer of development rights, TDRs, right? There are transferable development rights which can be transferred by one builder to another builder. There is no cost of those rights. So whatever you get now, those have been held to be not taxable, as these are again self-generated. Similarly, if I have a piece of land on which there are spontaneous growth of trees, I sell those trees. There cannot be any tax because these are again self-generated. If I own certain cows, those cows give birth to calves and I sell the calves. Again, these are self-generated, acquired without any cost. Hence, there cannot be a capital gain on this. So in respect of all capital assets where the cost is taken to be nil, which are self-generated, except the ones covered under 55 specifically, we can still take the cost to be nil and there will be no capital gains left. Then in respect of equity shares, listed equity shares, which were exempt till 31st of January 2018, now, as you are aware, these have become taxable with effect from 1st of February 2018. Now, when we made them taxable, there's a tax of 10% now, if these are long-term capital assets. There is a grandfathering clause which was inserted because we did not want to tax the capital gain which had arisen to the SSC till 31st of January. Therefore, we have provided here that the cost of acquisition of these shares shall be taken to be the lower of two elements. Firstly, the fair market value of the shares, first, we will take the actual cost of acquisition of these shares. And secondly, the lower of the fair market value of the shares on 31st of January 2018 and the full value of consideration, that is the sale price. To repeat it again, the cost of the shares shall be the higher of, firstly, the actual cost or be lower of fair market value or sale price, whichever is lower. So I'll have to take into account three considerations, three factors. What was my actual cost? What was the fair market value on 31st January 2018? And what is my actual selling price? So based on these three factors, I will determine what will be the cost of my shares when I sell these shares. Similarly, there are other few cases which I will deal with when I come to those specific provisions. A small point that I wanted to make here is the treatment of forfeiture of advance received for transfer of a capital asset. Earlier, whenever I used to enter into a transaction and the transaction was not completed and the advance money which I received was forfeited, then we used to have section 51 where we used to reduce the amount of forfeited amount from my cost. So my cost was reduced by the amount that I forfeited. Now that section 51 is no longer applicable. Now we have section 56(2)(9) which clearly provides that if any sum is forfeited on account of any negotiations which do not result in the transfer of the capital asset. That means I had entered into a transaction, I had received certain amount, subsequently the amount is forfeited and there is no transfer of the capital asset. Then this amount which is forfeited shall be deemed to be my income from other sources under section 56(2)(9). Friends, of course, this cannot be treated as a capital gain because of the mere fact that I have not transferred any capital asset. The asset still remains mine. So therefore, what we have done is, we have taxed this now under 56(2)(9). Friends, now I would like to deal with some specific cases of capital gains. Firstly, regarding certain transactions of a partnership firm, we have two specific sections dealing with that, section 45.3 and section 45.4. 45.3 deals with the case where a person introduces as his capital contribution certain assets in a firm where he becomes a partner. So a partner joins the firm by way of his capital contribution. Instead of giving any amount in cash or check, etc., he brings in a capital asset. Now the asset has transferred from the partner to the firm. This is now to be taxed as a capital gain in the hands of the partner. The sale consideration shall be the value at which the asset is recorded in the books of the firm. The amount for which the partner gets the credit, that is deemed to be a sale consideration minus his cost, etc. We will compute the capital gains in the hands of the partner. Controversies do arise here. What will happen if I bring in a immovable property as my capital contribution? Will section 50C apply? What if I bring in certain shares into my capital account? Will 50CA apply? Right? Now, most of the decisions which we have are to the effect that wherever any immovable property is transferred to the firm, 50C will become applicable. If shares have been transferred, 50CA will become applicable. Right? What do these two provisions specifically provide? We'll deal a little later. But yes, these two provisions will also become attracted in case of section 45.3. 45.4 deals with the situation where certain assets of the firm are distributed to the partners on dissolution of the firm or otherwise. Even reconstitution of firm, if the assets of the firm are distributed to the partners, then it is deemed to be a transfer. The firm now becomes liable to pay the capital gain tax on the asset which is distributed to the partners. So, and in this case, what we do is we take the market value of the asset on the date of distribution to be the sale consideration in the hands of the firm. Remember, it is on the date of the distribution, not on the date of dissolution. The market value, the date of the distribution of the asset to the partner, will be deemed to be the sale consideration in the hands of the firm. Now here again, one or two cases that arise. We have some cases where the business of the firm is reorganized, where let us say a couple of old partners retire and some new partners are introduced. The firm continues. The assets of the firm remain with the firm only. Sorry. The retiring partners are paid their capital, but whatever capital assets were there with the firm, those remain the assets of the firm. Will section 45.4 be attracted? Right? We have two, three very recent cases where it has been held that in this case, there is no transfer of assets by the firm, so therefore, no capital gain can be attracted. Right? We have Madras High Court in 409 ITR 514, and we have Mumbai High Court 178 DTR 316. This is very recent judgment of 2019, where it has been held that where the assets of the firm remain with the firm, merely the outgoing partners are paid in cash by check on account of their capital contribution, then there is no transfer. 45.4 will not be applied. We were dealing with section 45.1A, where I was talking about a new clause which was inserted to overcome the judgment of the Supreme Court in case of Vanya Silk Mills. Right? As I mentioned, Vanya Silk Mills had held that where the asset extinguishes, where the asset ceases to exist, there could not be a transfer. Now we introduce section 45.1A, which says that where any person receives at any time during the previous year any money or other assets under an insurance from an insurer on account of damage or destruction of a capital asset as a result of certain natural calamities, which could be flood, riots, accidental fire, enemy action, etc., then any profits or gains which arise shall be chargeable to tax under the head capital gains and shall be deemed to be the income of the year in which such money is received by the assess. So this section now particularly deals only with insurance claims. So if an asset has been insured, the asset is destroyed or damaged because of certain factors which are mentioned, maybe flood, riots, etc., then if the insurance company pays me any compensation, that will give a rise to a capital gain. However, this capital gain will be taxed only in the year in which I receive the compensation. As you know, it might take 4 years, 5 years to get the insurance claim settled. So if my asset has been destroyed, where do I pay the tax from? So therefore, the taxability has been postponed only to the year in which the money has been received from the insurance company. So this is section 45.1a. 45.2 deals with how to tax capital gain when a capital asset is converted into stock and trade. Now here, when I convert a capital asset into stock and trade, on the date of conversion, it is deemed to be a transfer. I compute the capital gain on that date, take the market value of the asset on that date to be my sale price, and I will compute the capital gain, which I will tax in the year in which I actually sell the asset. In the year of sale of the asset, there will be two taxes, one business income and secondly capital gain. Till recently, we had a situation where we were taxing conversion of a capital or conversion of a capital asset into stock in trade, but we had no circumstance, no provision dealing with the reverse case, where stock in trade is converted into a capital asset. Now we have introduced section 28. In section 28, we introduced clause 6A, which says that where any stock in trade is converted into a capital asset, the market value of the rate of conversion will be deemed to be the sale price, and that amount will be taxed as a business income. So I will compute my business income on the rate of conversion, tax that as my business income, and later on, now it will become my capital. When I sell it, I'll compute my capital gains. 20 straight away, coming now to section 50B. 50B talks about how to compute capital gains in case of a slump sale. What is a slump sale? Slump sale refers to a transaction where I transfer my entire undertaking for a lump sum consideration without assigning values to individual assets. Right? For example, I have a division where I'm manufacturing motorcycles. That undertaking may own certain machinery, plant, buildings, land, debtors, creditors, bank balances, stock in trade. All this undertaking, I agree to transfer for a consideration of 500 crores. I do not bifurcate that consideration. This is called a slump sale. It is covered in section 50B. Now 50B says that if I transfer undertaking by way of a slump sale, I know my selling price, the asset transfer is the undertaking rather than individual assets. My cost will be the value of the undertaking on the date of transfer. So I'll have to compute the net worth of the undertaking on the date of transfer, that becomes my cost. Capital gain will be long-term, short-term, depending upon my period of holding of that asset, of the undertaking. 50C talks about a deemed sale consideration in case of immovable properties. It specifically provides where the sale consideration for any, for transfer of any land, building or both is less than the stamp duty value, then the stamp duty value shall be deemed to be the consideration of that profit. Now we have introduced a tolerance level in that. This budget we have increased that to 10%, and now the provision says that if the stamp duty value exceeds 110% of the sale consideration, then only the stamp duty value will be taken to be the sale consideration of that property. So if the margin is within 10%, then I will stick to the original consideration. If it exceeds more than 10%, if the stamp duty value exceeds more than 10%, then it will be then the stamp duty value will become the sale consideration. I will just mention one more point and then I will come to the development agreements 45, 5A, etc. This is the provision regarding buyback of shares. When a company buybacks the shares from its shareholders, we have a specific provision under section 115QA which imposes the tax on the company. Earlier, this provision was applicable only when an unlisted company would purchase shares from its shareholders. Recently, we increased that, the scope of that section, even to listed companies. So now, whenever there is a buyback of the shares, then the company pays about 20% tax on the buyback, on the amount of premium, and this amount will now be exempt in the hands of the shareholders. We have section 115QA on this. Now coming to the transfer in development agreements. Now I would like to deal with, I'll take just 5 more minutes on this. I will deal with 2 aspects on this. Certain transactions which are covered under section 45.5A, which was newly inserted, and other transactions which will be covered under 247.5. That is the definition of the term transfer. Now first, let us come to section 45.5A. 45.5A now provides, it is 45.5A, as you would be aware, is applicable only in case of individuals and HU. Wherever there is an agreement for development of any immovable property, right? What does 45.5A says? It says where the capital gain arises to an individual or HUF from the transfer of a capital asset, being land or building or both, which is transferred under a specified agreement, the capital gain shall be chargeable as income of the previous year in which the certificate of completion for the whole or part of the project is issued by the competent authority. See, what was the need of this section 45.5A? Before this was inserted with effect from assessment year 18-19, the transactions of development agreements were covered under 247.5. 247 clause 5 said that as soon as I give the possession of the property, it is deemed to be a transfer. Therefore, the assessee was stuck with the tax liability as soon as he entered into the agreement by which the possession was given to the builder. The problem arose that he has only given the possession, he has not received any consideration today, so where does he pay the capital gain tax from? And then there were a lot of disputes as to whether 47.5 will apply or will not apply. So in order to settle that dispute, 45.5A was introduced, but only applicable to individuals and HUF. Now, if these individuals and HUF enter into a specified agreement, what is a specified agreement? Specified agreement refers to a registered agreement. Remember, it is a registered agreement, it has to be registered, in which a person owning land or building agrees to allow another person to develop a real estate project on such land or building or both in consideration of a share being land or building or both in such project, whether with or without payment or part of the consideration cash. we come across so many cases where a person, an individual, owns any property, maybe an old house property he owns, which he now wants to redevelop. He does not have the resources, so he approaches a builder, enters into an agreement with the builder, I will give you this property, you build four flats on this, and in consideration, you can retain one flat, three flats you give to me. Now, what have I done under this? Am I covered under specific agreement? If this is registered, then the person owning the land or building has agreed to allow another person to develop a real estate project. What is the consideration? I will get three constructed flats. Maybe along with this, I will get some consideration in cash. Maybe there is no cash. So if this is the specific agreement, then 45(5)A says that this capital gain will now be taxable only in the year in which the completion certificate has been obtained. This is section 45(5)A. If my transaction is not covered under 45(5)A, then, right, for example, if this is a case for a company, a partnership firm, then I will have to resort back to section 247 clause 5, where as soon as the possession is given, it shall be deemed to be a transfer. Of course, subject to the Supreme Court rulings, that agreement also should be a registered agreement. I think, friends, I will stop here now. We have gone through most of the provisions, but due to paucity of time, maybe we had to miss out some provisions. If you have any queries on this, we will take them up in the question answer session. Now, Nehal, I think we can handle the questions now.
Yeah, Dr. Gupta, thank you very much. This has been very informational and we have a lot of questions for you. I'll start with some of them. So yeah. We have a question wherein the person has asked that in case of a firm having land and building as fixed asset and later on its sale, will it be considered as PGBP or CG? Firm is in the business of redevelopment of residential and commercial dwellings.
See, in this question, I had mentioned in the beginning of the talk that whether an asset is a capital asset or is it a stock in trade depends upon so many factors. In this case, you are mentioning that the firm is into the business of real estate development. So once I say it is in the business of real estate development, the normal presumption will be that the land and building held by it is also a capital, is also a stock in trade. However, facts can be different. If in my books I am showing this as a capital asset, I am not reflecting this as a stock in trade. This particular land and building, I do not want to construct for the purpose of business. I want to construct it to earn an income from this by way of rent, etc. It could be a capital. Otherwise, in normal circumstances, this would be treated as a business income.
Right. We have a question from Mr. Jignesh Kumar Parikh, who has asked that a family settlement has been executed between four brothers of a family, whereby the three brothers have agreed to pay a particular amount to fourth brother, whereby they will get share in the land acquired by the fourth brother under will from deceased father. Now, if the land is sold, then can three brothers claim the value paid during family settlement as cost of acquisition while calculating capital gain? What will be the scenario if in this case the land in question is not acquired under will deceased father but is a self-acquired asset?
There are two or three points involved in this question. First of all, let us be clear that whenever there's a family settlement, it is not considered to be a transfer. So normally in case of family settlement, there is no capital gain tax liability because we say that in a family settlement, we are not transferring any rights. We are merely realignment the rights which are already available with the family member. We have Supreme Court of case in Kale, and we have A.R. Ramanathan case, where the Supreme Court has held that in case of family settlement, there is no transfer. Now here the question is a little different. That first of all, the point mentioned is that they have acquired the property through will. And then amongst the four brothers, they have made a family settlement. when they make a payment to the fourth brother on account of his giving up the right in the land, then there is no transfer. There will be no capital gain tax liability at this stage. However, when the three brothers sell their share in the land, then there will be a capital gain tax liability on them. At that point of time, their cost will be the cost to the original owner plus the cost they have paid to their brother to acquire his right. So therefore, both of these will become a part of their cost. The amount paid to their brother can be taken to be the cost of improvement, because by that they have enhanced the value of their asset. So that can be taken as a deduction. Second point of the second part of the question, it said that what would happen if these are self-acquired assets? Now that would raise a question whether you can have a family settlement in respect of self-acquired property. When you have a self-acquired property, did your brother have a right in that? If he does not have any right, then can I enter into a settlement for such a property? Right? That is a moot question. According to my information, you could not have entered into a family settlement in respect of self-acquired properties. That is my take on that question.
I will put forth another question by Ms. Anshul Gupta. She has asked that if on the sale of a residential house owned by joint owners, LTCG arises, can the owners claim exemption under Section 54 and 54F against their proportionate share of LTCG?
Yes, if the property was in the name of the two joint owners, they sell it. In fact, both of them can claim exemption under Section 54 if they invest their own individual shares, which they got on the sale of the property, in separate houses. Or they may agree to buy a joint property. In both the cases, they will be eligible for claiming exemption under Section 54. Under Section 54, in fact, earlier exemption was available only if you acquire one house. Now, from last year, we have increased that exemption for purchase of two houses, provided the capital gain is up to rupees 2 crores. So even two houses can be acquired if the capital gain was up to 2 crores. Otherwise, you can acquire one house each.
There is a question. It's Suman Bijarnia, who has asked that in case of buyback for listed company, the CG is calculated a difference between amount to be paid to shareholder minus amount received at the time allotment. So is the indexation would be provided for this initial amount of receipt?
No. In case of 115QA, there is no provision for indexation. Whatever is the amount paid to the shareholder minus the amount which the company had received at the time of allotment, that balance is taxable at 20%. No indexation benefit is allowed.
Right. There is a question by Mr. Cable, who has asked that can cost of improvement in case of immovable property include interest and loans taken to acquire that immovable property? If yes, please suggest computation and indexation method for cost of improvement for interest cost.
Well, we have a case of Delhi High Court, which is CIT versus Mithilesh Kumari, in which case the courts have clearly said that if I pay any interest for acquiring capital asset, that interest will also become a part of my cost. And in that case, in the years, in respective years in which I paid the interest, the courts have allowed indexation from that year respectively. So if I have paid the interest over the last 7 years, I can claim indexation for each year separately. Starting from the year in which I made the payment of the interest till the year of sale, I can index each interest payment. This is CIT versus Mithilesh Kumari, Delhi High Court.
Okay, so I'll take up the next question now. This is that if a land qualifies as an agricultural land based on the definition under Section 214, is it necessary that agricultural activities must be carried on to claim exemption?
Yes, see, for qualifying as agricultural land, there are two prerequisites. One, it must be agricultural land, that is, there must be agriculture on that land. Secondly, it must be within that specified area. So it should be beyond 2 kilometers, 6 kilometers, etc. And the primary condition, it must be used for agricultural purposes. If the land has not been used for agricultural purposes, then it does not qualify to be agricultural land. Can we come to the next question?
Yeah, I'm taking up some more questions. I'm looking at a question by Mr. Kannan. He has asked that an assessee sells an agricultural land. However, no agricultural activity has been done by him and no agricultural income is shown in his returns. Can we take a stand that it is not a capital asset if all the conditions regarding the rural number of kilometers from the nearest municipality and land is sold as agricultural land? Will the answer be different if the buyer is a corporate and intends to commercially exploit the same?
See, in this case, why is the buyer buying it? What is the consideration of the buyer? That is not important. In fact, that is not relevant at all. If I am selling my agricultural land to a company which will develop a project on that, it still remains an agricultural land for me. So what the buyer will do with that land is not relevant. But here the question arises, what is this agricultural land in my hands? Now, as you are saying that there was no agricultural income declared, declaring agricultural income is not necessary. I might be doing agriculture on it. Whatever is grown on it, I consume it myself. I distribute it free of cost. So it is not necessary that there must be agricultural income. The only thing that becomes relevant is what do the agriculture records say? If the records of the Patwari, the revenue records, if they show that there has been some agricultural activities on that, this can be agricultural land. Irrespective of the fact that I have not shown any agricultural income from that land.
Right. There's one more question, which is that will goodwill paid by incoming partners to the firm or the existing partners be taxable?
When a partner joins a firm and he pays something towards the goodwill of the firm, the question is, has the goodwill been transferred? Right? There's nothing which the firm has transferred. He's just making a contribution of his own share. So therefore, there cannot be a capital gain when he is introduced. When he retires and he gets some consideration over and above his capital in the firm, again, in that case also, it is not only on account of goodwill that he gets it. So, unless and until there is a specific clause in the dissolution deed which says that this amount is paid to him on account of transfer of the goodwill, then it cannot be taxed as a transfer of goodwill in the hands of the firm. Normally, it is not taxable because no one specifies that this is on account of transfer of the goodwill of the firm. The firm continues. The goodwill remains with that of the firm. So therefore, it is not a transfer of goodwill by the firm.
Right. There is one more question, which is that if proprietor having continuing business and held immovable property as fixed asset, can he introduce another person as partner? Capital gain applicable to proprietor or not?
He can introduce anyone as a partner. Now, when the question would arise that he was originally the sole owner of that property. When he introduces someone as a partner, then maybe his share is diluted. Now he will give a proportionate share in the assets to that partner also. That will amount to a transfer and then can come under the purview of taxability of the capital gain. Right? Because he is transferring his share, which he held 100% share in the assets, now he is transferring it to a partner who will also become, let us say, 50% or 40% right in that property. So that can be taken to be a transfer.
Right, sir. So there's one more question. We actually have time for two or three more now. And I'll take one by Mr. Umesh Bhatt, which is the taxability of earnout on transfer of shares. The earnout will be determined at a later date based on the achievement of some criteria like turnover, profit, etc. And only the maximum earnout is determined now in the criteria for work out the earnout.
Okay. What I could understand is that you are entering into an agreement today to transfer certain shares at a value to be determined later. Right? So in this case, the moot question is, when am I transferring the ownership of the shares? am I transferring at the shares today or will I transfer the shares later on? If I am transferring the shares today, even though the value will be determined later, it will give rise to a capital gain today itself. Right? The value will be determined later on. I can compute my capital gains today and later on I can make a rectification that if the value changes. I may also resort to section 50D in this case. 50D contains a provision where it mentions that if the consideration is not determinable today, then the market value of that asset today may be taken to be the same consideration. So whatever is the market value of the shares today, we will deem that to be the same consideration and that will become taxable today. Later on, I may have to change that computation even when the value is finally determined. But I cannot postpone the taxability merely because the consideration price is not fixed.
Dr. Gupta, we are going to take a question by Hitendra Bhandari. The question is that A entered into an agreement to acquire property and paid 10% advance. The owner subsequently sold the property to another buyer, B, who was an existing tenant of the property. A filed suit for specific performance and or damages. Later, developer entered into an agreement and settled A. The compensation received by A represents amount received against right to sue, which cannot be transferred as per Section 6 of Transfer of Property 1882, and hence not a capital asset and hence not taxable. What are your views on this?
I could not get that question properly. Could you repeat that, please?
Yeah, sure.
Take a few points on that.
So A has entered into an agreement to acquire property and paid 10% advance. The owner subsequently sold the property to another buyer, B, who was an existing tenant of the property. A filed suit for specific performance and or damages. Later, developer entered into an agreement and settled A. The compensation received by A represents amount received against right to sue, which cannot be transferred as per Section 6 of Transfer of Property 1882, and hence not a capital asset and hence not taxable. What are your views on this?
I agree. There are two elements involved in this. First one is that he had paid in advance. Now, by paying that advance, he got a certain right. That right is a capital asset. Now, when he enters into an agreement to relinquish that right, right? So then that will give a rise to a capital gain. I mentioned earlier also in my talk, we have a Supreme Court judgment in Vijay Flexible Containers, where it said that a right in an immovable property, a right to acquire an immovable property itself is a valuable right, which can give a rise to a capital gain. The second point that he's mentioning is also correct, that transfer or relinquishment of right to sue is not a capital asset. Now here it will have to be seen as to what is the compensation being received by him on account of. Is that on account of the surrendering of his right to purchase the property, or is it in right of his right to sue the developer? So if the court is giving him compensation only for foregoing the right to sue, which I don't think there is a value attached to that, then it may not be a capital gain. But 99%, the consideration being received by him will be on account of transfer of the right to purchase the property, the right to forgive that specific right. So therefore, that will give rise to a capital gain. So if I look at the complete order of the court, we will have to see, analyze it minutely. But according to my understanding, this will be taxable as a capital.
Now, Mr. Right. has asked that in case of long-term capital asset acquired before 1st April 2001, and if the cost of acquisition is more than the fair market value, can we consider the cost instead of FMV as on 1st April 2001?
Yes, that option is available to the CC. In fact, the provision says that he can take either the actual cost or the fair market value as on 1/4/2001, whichever is beneficial for the SIS. So if the actual cost before 1000-2001 is beneficial for him, he can take that to be his cost. Only when the fair market value is 1/4-2001 happens to be more than the actual cost, then he goes for the option of 1/4-2001. Otherwise, he can always take the actual cost prior to that. That option is available.
Right, sir. We have one more question here, which is that family settlement happened by way of transfer of shares of companies where business is happening. Whether is it exempt or not?
Under a family settlement, whatever assets are exchanged between members of the family, there is no capital gain tax line. So if members had shares of certain companies, A had 20% shares, B had 15% shares, C had 30% shares, and they tried to change those shareholding. Right, the percentage of shareholding changes, or one brother gives up his shares to another brother, then in that case, there will be no capital gain tax. However, there are restrictions on the transfer of the assets of the company. Right, these three brothers are shareholders of a company. Can the assets of the company also form a part of the family settlement? We have decisions which say no. Company cannot be a part of the settlement, although shareholding of each member of the family, the shares held by them, that can be a matter of settlement. In that case, there will be no capital gain tax.
And now I can see that some people have raised their hands. If there is a question that either of you would like to ask, I'll quickly go over to you and give you the mic over to speak. Please, Mr. Niranjan Vaidya, please ask your question. You may want to unmute yourself so that you'll be able to talk and we'll be able to hear you, please.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you.
Hello. Sir, you know, in one of the cases, some agriculturist, a poor agriculturist of a small village, had sold his land and a register agreement was entered into for a higher amount, say 1 crore. And then he was paid cash of 90 lakhs. Then in next year, the seller, the purchaser executed a sell deed on the jantri rate, which was less than 11 lakhs. So he, without referring this earlier registered agreement, he executed a sell deed stating that 11 lakhs as a purchase price. Now, the farmer had put all this cash received by him in his bank account. Then he claimed that even though the sell price is not mentioned, the sell deed, it is a sale of agriculture, sale proceeds of agriculture land, and it was not capital asset, so it is it should be exempt. Please, sir.
Niranjan, see, this will bring you to the question of applicability of Section 68. See, he has deposited cash in his bank account. Now, how does he explain the source of that cash? See, now, he has entered into a subsequent sale deed where he has consideration as per that sale deed. That is separately reflected in his bank account. Now, the question is, the explainability of the cash which was deposited, if he shows that this is out of the cash received on account of the earlier agreement which was not executed, then of course it is taxable under 56.29, I just explained. And if he says this is a part of the same transaction, same consideration, then again it will become taxable. So it has to be either unexplained income or it has to be part of the sale consideration. It cannot be exempt income. Right? Because that amount has been deposited in his bank account, he will have to explain the nature and the source of that deposit.
Right? Mr. Hopefully that answers your question. Okay, I'll move over to Mr. Sameer. If Mr. Sameer, you would now please ask your question directly.
Yeah. Good afternoon, sir. My question is that in case of an immovable property owned by two co-owners, with equal share having aggregate cost of rupees 50 lakhs is introduced in the partnership firm as their contribution by crediting 75 lakhs to the account of said two partners. So now the question is that is there any transfer within the meaning of section 50C? Because section 43(5) is a deeming provision wherein the act of introducing itself is treated as a transfer, whereas section 50C is applicable. If I understand correctly, then it is applicable only within the meaning of section 2 into bracket 47. Otherwise, I think that the consequences which will emerge because of that difference, which will be taxable in the hands of the partner, and later on, if the firm is selling at a stamp duty value, I think we will not be give a consistent result. I hope I'm clear on my query.
Your question is clear. I get that point. I had specifically mentioned this also. Now, when the partner is bringing in an immovable property as his contribution in the firm, it is covered by 45(3). Right? You are clear on that. Now, 45(3) says that the sale consideration shall be the value at which it is recorded in the books of the firm. Now, the question that arises is that if that property is recorded in the books at a value less than the circle rate, less than the stamp duty value, can I invoke section 56? Can I invoke section 50C in that? Now, 50C, if you will see, is an overriding section. And 50C will also be applicable in section 45(3). It does not give any exception there. It says wherever the consideration for the transfer of removed property is less than the stamp duty value, then 50C becomes applicable. So this was a debatable issue, but now we have two or three decided cases on this where it has been held that even in cases of 45(3), 50C, 50CA will become applicable. In fact, we also have a case where they have said that even transfer pricing provisions may become applicable. So all these provisions will become applicable even in case of 45(3). So this is as per the latest case clause on this. If you want, I'll give you the citation also on this. Yes. But yes, 50C has become applicable even in cases of 45(3). Yes.
Right. Thank you. Can you mail me the citation?
If you can
mail. The mail ID is available with the...
I'll mail it to you. I'll mail it.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Yarik, do you have any more questions?
I'll go to a question by Ms. Kiran Bidada now. I am unmuting her. Ma'am, if you can please ask your question now. Ms. Kiran, are you there? I'll move over to Mr. Prateek Sharma now, if he would like to ask his question.
Hello.
Hi, Prateek ji, we can hear you.
Yes, sir. I would like to seek the clarification on the taxability of development agreements. So what happened is this section 45A is applicable on area sharing agreement. So what happened where there is only a pure revenue sharing agreement? A landowner is transferring land directly to buyers. No possession is given to the developer. Only a license to develop is given under the development agreement.
For applicability of 45(5A, first thing is that there must be a specified agreement. Now, I have talked about what is a specified agreement.
Mm-hmm.
Now, specified agreement, we had said, means a registered agreement in which a person owning land or building agrees to allow another person to develop it, to develop a real estate project, in consideration of a share, being land or building or both, whether with or without payment of consideration in cash. So consideration in cash is not very relevant. What is relevant is that the consideration should be in the form of share in the land or building or both.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So if the owner is not getting a share in the land or building, then it is not a specified agreement. Then 45(5A is not applicable at all.
So when the capital gain will arise in that case?
In that case, we will have to come back to section 247 clause 5. As soon as the possession of the property is handed over, this will be deemed to be a transfer, and then the capital gain will rise in the year as in which the possession is handed over.
So the landowner is not transferring possession to the developer, he is giving only license to develop.
Okay, yes.
He will be transferring possession as well as the land itself to the buyers directly at the time of sale deed.
So
can we say sale deed ki time pe transfer?
Yes, it is transfer. If your agreement clearly specifies that the possession will remain with the owner, developer only gets a right, a license to construct the project. The actual legal possession remains with the
landowner.
Then if the taxability will be postponed till the time that the actual sale deeds are registered in the name of the subsequent buyers.
Okay, okay. Yes,
but if the agreement does not mention that the possession will remain with the buyer, then 247.5 can be moved.
Can be moved. Yeah, okay. Thank you, sir.
Welcome, sir. Welcome.
I'd like to now go over to a question by Subrata Ray. You may please ask your question now.
Mr. Ray, are you there?
I think we don't have Mr. Ray here. I'll move over to the next question, which is by Mr. Kanishk Mehta. Please ask your question, Mr. Mehta.
Good evening, sir.
Yes.
Can you please explain me about taxability of ESOPs, employee stock option plan?
Okay. See, ESOPs, till recently, were being taxable in the hands of the employees at two stages. Stage one, where the employee would exercise the right to acquire the shares. At that point of time, it was deemed to be a person taxable in the hands of the employee. So he would have to pay the tax on the difference between the issue price and the market value of the share on the date of the exercise of the right. That was deemed to be a perquisite, and he would have to pay tax on that. Secondly, when the employee would sell those shares, then there could be a capital gain. So capital gain will be the sale price of the shares minus the market value of the share on the date of exercise. That will give rise to a capital. So that will be taxable in the year of sale. Now the problem faced by the employee was that the first stage tax which he has to pay when he exercised the right, at that point of time it was taxed as a perquisite. He has not even realized any amount. So how could he pay that tax? Where would he pay the tax from? And these shares normally have a lock-in period of 3 to 5 years. So he did not have the liquidity to pay that tax. So in this budget, in the Finance Act 2020, we have given a relaxation there. Now, the first stage tax will happen only after a period of 4 years from the date of exercise of his right, or on the date when he sells the shares, or on the date that he leaves the employment, whichever is earlier. So now the first stage tax has been postponed for almost about 4 years. So now the employee gets a sufficient time period in that. Maybe the lock-in period also elapses after 4 years, so he can even sell the shares to pay the tax. So that is a relief which has been provided in the Finance Act 2020. Any further queries on that?
No, sir. This is clear. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Patel.
We'll now take one last question from Ms. Lavleen Agarwal. Ms. Agarwal, if you can please ask your question now.
Good day, sir. This is Lavleen.
Yes, please.
Sir, in case of a development agreement, the owner gets 3 residential flats from the builder, yes, out of 4. So will he be eligible to claim deduction under section 54 for all the 3 flats or just for 2 flats?
Well, that again was a very disputed point, but we have a very clear judgment of the Delhi High Court, in which case the SLP has also been dismissed by the Supreme Court. This is CIT versus Geeta Duggal. In fact, this was my own SSC. I had handled this case right from the beginning, which was a very similar case that you're mentioning. In that case, the courts have held that if there are three flats in the same house, they constitute one house. And even if these three flats are being used separately, they have a separate entrance, separate kitchen, but still they'll be deemed to be one house and the assessee will be eligible to claim exemption in respect of all the three flats. This is CIT versus Geeta Duggal, Delhi High Court.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. With this, we'd like to call this a wrap. Thank you, Mr. Gupta. This was a very informational session. I hope everybody who attended this found this useful as well. And hopefully next time we'll meet everybody really soon.
Thank you, Neha ji. Thank you, all the participants. Thank you.